Thank you, Sylvie, for the introduction to the program. The program is very large. There are a lot of components. We don't have time to cover all of them. It would take actually one full hour to cover all the components. So we will mostly focus on the one of the components, which is the contemporary atlas. And this is the URL. If you want to follow along with us, you're welcome to do that, because there will be a lot of interactive mapping here, and you can follow and just try how this works on your own as well. So this is gis.huri.harvard.edu. This is the website where all the modules are on this website. So let me go quickly into this. So apart from the interactivity, we will have static maps, but also we have a number of articles and narrative text here that explain the project, and we also have some spatial analysis articles as well here. So we'll go straight to the Revolution of Dignity web map. So this project consists basically of three sub-modules. And they're described here. I'll just go through this very quickly. The history and identity module, as part of the MAPA program, aims to contribute to reconceptualization of regionalism in Ukraine. And the project uses GIS, or Geographic Information Systems technology, to map and analyze sociological data. And the project also contributes to the comparative cross-regional analysis of identities and historical memories in today's Ukraine, using GIS. Quickly about GIS, if people don't know about that. So this is the technology of GIS consists of two pieces, maps and data. Every year we have a GIS fellow whose job is to collect data, and then my job is to map that data, and then we work on the spatial analysis of what we have on the maps. And very often when you just have data in tables, you will not see a lot of patterns that have become evident once you put that data on the maps. This is basically what GIS is all about in this instance in our program. The other module that will be there in that same web map is the language module. And that module explores and visualizes changes in the sociolinguistic landscape of Ukrainian society between 2013 and 2017. So in addition to the geographic component, these maps have a temporal component. You can do analysis within the geographic units, but also across time. And in these maps, we have surveys from 2013, 15, and 17, which, as you know, the revolution happens in 2014. So these surveys will allow you to see pre-revolution survey data and post-revolution survey data. And you'll see later that there are few things that we were not able to compare because of the situation in Crimea and Donbass. So the data for those regions was not included in the 2015 and 17 surveys. But the rest of the surveys you can compare across all the regions of Ukraine. And there is another module there, it's called the statistics module, which aims to visualize a number of demographic, social, economic, and political variables and see how they evolved during the key years of presidential election in Ukraine. So these are the years that we have statistics information for, 94, 99, 2004, 2010, and 14. And what that gives you is gives you a background information to the survey data, because these are statistical information, but also census information. So when I will show you later how the maps interact, you can take population density, for instance, or income, and compare it with survey questions. So basically we have hundreds of maps, but when you combine several maps, you go into hundreds and hundreds of different combinations of maps with data and with charts and colors, and you'll see that in a minute how this all works. So from here, if you click on any of these links, you go straight to the web map. So this is based on the web builder, ASEEES is the company that makes this product. So we took that product and we put the data into it and mapped the data that we have. So for the information about the data, you can go quickly here to this this icon. This is a these are different tools that we'll go into very quickly. But basically, what you're working with here is the tool, this area with the map, and these are the layers. You can call them maps as well, but for this particular application, we'll call them layers. So I just don't have time to go through the data, but the data is described here, how representative it is, where it came from. Now we'll go here quickly to the, as you can see on this map, there's a base map in the background, and there's this white map of Ukraine on top, and that is because one of the layers, so all of the layers are disabled by default, except for this one. See, under administrative maps, 2001, oblast regions. That's the only one map that is enabled by default. So to enable a layer or a map here, make sure that the top group layer is enabled, because if I click here, but this piece is unclicked, see, the map will not be visible, so you have to click here. So as you can see, the group layers, the groups, they are already enabled. All you have to do then choose subgroups and sublayer within that group to enable that. As I mentioned earlier, some of the data is for 2015 and 17, so in that case, you have to enable this layer for the next Crimea and this layer for the occupied territory of Donbass in the next to display data for 15 and 17. All right, so these are the modules, as I described to you earlier. History and identity, language, and statistics is divided into these subcategories here, and they go by year. We also have administrative maps, also revolution of granite, will be presented later. So there is a lot of information in statistics. If you just click, let's say, 2001, you see there are a number of sublayers here, and you have a lot of different information on the language, on nationality, on population. All these layers can be combined with the data from the surveys. Now let's make, so let's just do a quick, we'll combine a couple of layers, and I'll show you how you can actually work with the data as well. Because the difference between GIS and regular maps, that here we present you the data, you have the data, but you can also create your own maps. On top of the layers that we present here, you can actually take our data, you can fill the data out, you can change different things, and you can create your own maps. And I'll show you how to do that. So we'll go to history and identity. As you can see, there are two subgroups here. Color maps, we'll call them for simplicity, and chart maps. Color maps are these polygons, and when you map data on top of these, so different shades of colors represent different values. This is a survey question for the support of Euromaidan that was done in March 2015. And the full question, when I just enabled that layer, the map showed up right away here. And this is, now the shades of this color represent obviously different values now of one variable, because for the polygon maps, for the color maps, only one variable can be represented at a time, as opposed to the chart maps where you can have one or more variables represented on the map. So when you click on any of these regions, see these are polygons, so these regions, the pop-up shows up with the actual question of the survey, and the one that is involved is the answer that was picked to be represented on this map. So this is I support and supported Euromaidan March 2015. This is Volhyn region, 69% support. Now we can go. Now obviously you cannot, it's difficult to compare two color maps because they will just, one of them will be on top of another. But we can go to the chart maps. In this case, we'll go to the monuments and we'll choose this chart. And this chart question, if you click on here, so the first, see the pop-up window opens. First you have the first question is one or two. So we have, because we have now two maps, obviously we have two pop-up windows. The first one is about the support for Euromaidan, and the second is support for the monuments to Bandera and Lenin in your region. And the second one represents 2013, but also 2015. And this is, these are the percentages of support for those monuments in those regions. Now, as you can, so what we can do right away here, just look at this visually and kind of see if there is any correlation. You can right away see there is some. Obviously, there is more support for Bandera in the regions where there was a higher support for Euromaidan. Picture in the middle, though, is not that clear. South and east is kind of more clear, like the west. But the middle is the picture is more interesting. So how? So now this is where the GIS component of interactivity comes into play. See, these are the tools that you can use to actually work with the data. Well, first the data, you can see the data in table if you open this attribute table. Okay. And this is monuments to Bandera 2015. So this is supporting percentage. If you click here, you go to statistics, you have very simple statistics. Definitely this is not a program for statistical analysis. Has just a little bit of statistics there. And then you can see the number of values, it's 26 regions. Then you have minimum 2, maximum 88, average 27, and standard deviation 27. Now I'm going to show you one of the tools. It's a filter tool. So these are predefined three filters here, and then there is a tool here that you can actually create your own filter. So we'll start with here. So let's say we want to only show percent of support for Euromaidan 15 higher. Okay, so now these are the regions where support for Euromaidan is 50% and higher. And you can see this is West and Central Ukraine. Some of these regions, so the rest of the regions support is less than 50%. Now if you want to see correlation between that and Bandera Monument, see the that variable is not predefined here, so you go to this custom filter, choose the layer. You remember it was under history and identity. And we'll go to chart maps, and we'll go to monuments, and here's monuments. Then we'll say add an expression here. So I'm gonna start typing monument, and here we go, monument. We'll choose 2015. We'll apply the same expression is greater than, and let's choose 50%. Okay. Now you see if this what this is an interesting picture now. I'm not a researcher, I'm not gonna go into the argument about correlation between these things, but often you hear argument that Euromaidan was really not a Ukraine-wide phenomenon, but was mainly people, what they call Banderites, the people who support extreme nationalist agenda. Well, this map shows that it's not really like that, because some of these regions, yes, there is a high support for Euromaidan here, where the support for Bandera is high as well. Yet when you take at the central regions, there's a more than 50% support for Euromaidan, there is definitely less than 50% support for Bandera. And now you can start fine-tuning this data here. Let's try 30%. Okay, one region now shows up here, right? We can keep going like that. And now we have a picture. The difference here is very interesting, right? Support for Euromaidan in these two regions is lower than now in these regions. So the correlation between support for the Bandera monument and support for Euromaidan is not so direct. And this is when you then start applying maybe a statistical software to make analysis. Okay. Any questions so far?
Well, we'll have a general discussion.
Okay. But so basically what we're trying to create here is a resource tool where people can go look at these maps, take the data, and really start working with it. We do have some of the articles here which represent our understanding of the data and our example of spatial analysis, but the main purpose of this module is to be a resource for scholars where they can go and using these different tools like filters and charts and things like that, so they can come up with their own research results. And because all these maps you can then print out, use for your research papers. But the point here is that this is a tool that can be used in your papers, can be used for spatial analysis, and we even give you data. You can look at actual numbers as opposed to like a regular map where you cannot see the data and use for your research.